like this, where you have a far-flung stake. Some of you have to drive a very long time to come to a stake center. This is just my kind of a stake. The first stake over which I presided in Arkansas was about 270 miles north and south, 260 or 70 miles east and west, and we had 17 units. So those of you who drive less than that, I don't feel sorry for you. To get to the stake center for me, it was 84 miles on a two-lane road through the Boston Mountains that took about an hour and 50 minutes. So I think I know a little bit about some of your units and some of what you experience, and I hope you count your many blessings. When I moved from that to Rexburg, Idaho, which I think is the most densely populated, exclusively LDS community on the planet. Our stake center, our stake was like four square blocks, and the stake center was across the street. And I thought it was a sin walking to church. It just can't be right. So, brothers and sisters, I don't know who you are individually, I couldn't recite your names, but as I look into your faces, I know who you are. And this is my kind of a stake, and it is a blessing for me to be here with you. I want to begin today by speaking specifically and directly to those in attendance here and in the other locations who are not members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. You honor us with your presence. Thank you for accepting an invitation to come and be here with us today. I'd like to briefly help you understand the name of this church, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I suspect for you the first portion of that name is quite clear and understandable, the Church of Jesus Christ. What may be a little confusing, even perplexing to you, is the latter part of the name, of Latter-day Saints. Let me explain. We believe in God, the Eternal Father, and in His Son, Jesus Christ, and in the Holy Ghost. Jesus the Christ is the only begotten Son of the Eternal Father, and He lived on the earth a little more than 2,000 years ago. When Jesus lived upon the earth, He established His church. And by a church, we don't mean a building, a bell, or a stained glass window. The Church of Jesus Christ was a group or a body of believers who followed Jesus Christ in living His teachings. In the New Testament, those believers, those members of His church, were referred to as saints. Therefore, when you read in the New Testament, when Paul writes to the saints in Ephesus, he's writing to the regular, ordinary, day-to-day members of the church, providing direction and instruction. Now, that church had the doctrine of Christ. Doctrine is truth. It comes from God. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So He was the source of the doctrine and the truth that was taught. That church also had the authority to act in the name of Jesus Christ. The pattern for receiving the authority to act in the name of God is clearly established in the New Testament. One does not receive authority by studying in a seminary or a theological institute. Authority is not granted through a diploma. You do not look into the clouds or study the scriptures and feel called and receive authority to act in the name of God. The Savior placed His hands upon His apostles and said, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you." And by the laying on of hands, He conferred the authority to act in His name upon His servants. The apostles were not the only leaders in the church who had that authority. Others received it as well. Deacons, evangelists, pastors, and so forth. Now, brothers and sisters, that ancient church was rejected. The doctrine was perverted, and the ordinances performed by that proper authority were corrupted. Now, that sounds harsh, but it wasn't a surprise. Prophets and apostles anciently foretold the falling away of that ancient church. There is a pattern of prophecy in the New Testament foretelling the removal of that church from the earth. That ancient church established by Christ himself with his doctrine and his authority could be called the Church of Jesus Christ of long time ago saints, or the Church of Jesus Christ of ancient days saints. But in the New Testament, you also find a pattern of prophecy foretelling the reestablishment or the restoring of that Church of Jesus Christ to the earth again in the latter days in preparation for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, to those of you not of our faith, humbly but affirmatively, we declare to you that this church, even the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, is that same Church of Jesus Christ. Not founded by Joseph Smith, not founded by Thomas S. Monson, not even led by Joseph Smith or Thomas S. Monson. These names refer to men who have been prophets of God. But the head of this church is identified in the name, the Church of Jesus Christ, of Latter-day Saints, restored to the earth in this dispensation or in this season of the history of the earth. Joseph Smith, as a young boy, was concerned about the welfare of his own soul. He attended a number of different Christian denominations. He wanted to find out which church was true so he would know which church to join. He didn't just want to know. He wanted to act. Faith in Jesus Christ is a principle of action and of power. So he wanted to know which church was right so he could then direct his faith in the proper way and join the Church of Jesus Christ. He went to a number of different Christian denominations and he was frankly perplexed by what he found. Because in each denomination they would use similar or identical scriptural justification for very different beliefs and practices. He read the Bible one day, read the Bible a lot, but on a particular day he read in the book of James that says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, and it shall be given him. May I suggest to you the key in that scripture is the phrase, ask in faith. You don't ask just to know, you ask with the expectation to act. He wanted to know which church was right, so he would then know which church to join. He went to a grove of trees not far from his family's farm and he knelt in prayer. Now, to all of you, but in particular those of you who are not members of the church, I invite your attention. In response to that boy's humble prayer, God the Eternal Father and his Son Jesus Christ appeared to him. They spoke with him and they instructed him. I bear witness that is true. In the world today, it's quite common for people to have a reaction such as this to that description of what happened to Joseph Smith. That could not happen. God does not reveal himself, and he certainly would not reveal himself to a young boy. To a person with such a reaction, I pose just one simple question. Why? Why wouldn't God do that? The Old Testament is a record of God's dealings with his people, and he revealed himself to his servants and to others. The New Testament is a record of God's dealings with his children here upon the earth, and he spoke to his children, he had authorized servants, and he revealed himself. God has always spoken. There has always been revelation. With all due respect, I intend no arrogance. I certainly don't want to be offensive. It is the epitome of arrogance to proclaim that God no longer speaks and that he doesn't speak today. There's some in other denominations who claim that everything that we need to have is found in the Bible. Where does it say that? It doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible. There are some who take a verse at the latter part of Revelations that says, oh, you can't add to the words of this book. Surely people know that there was no such thing as a Bible at the time that that revelation was given. That was an individual letter written by an apostle. And it refers to that book, and you can find exactly the same thing in the book of Deuteronomy. Therefore, everything in the Bible after Deuteronomy, if you take that literally, you have to jettison. Obviously, that's not what it meant. There was no such thing as a book called the Bible. Humbly, but affirmatively, we declare God speaks today as he has always spoken. Now, to those of you not of our faith, if what I just described is true, then we desire to share with you the message that Christ lives. Yes, he was crucified, but even more significantly is that he is resurrected and he lives. And he speaks and directs the affairs of his church in these latter days through his chosen servants. If that message is true, then it's the greatest message you can ever hear while you live on this earth. Therefore, we invite you to come to church with us and hear this message. And you may think we're kind of obnoxious because we invite you to come and we keep trying to give you a copy of the Book of Mormon or things to read so that you can learn about this message. And you may have in your mind or heart this thought, why don't you folks in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints lighten up and leave me alone? I have my own church. I'm pretty happy. So why don't you quit bugging me? Could I explain why we will probably never stop inviting you to hear this message? Number one, it's because we love you. We simply share with you that which matters most. We don't get bonus points or a trip to Hawaii if you come to church. No one's keeping score. We just love the gospel of Jesus Christ. It has changed and transformed us, and we want to share that with you. An illustration from our three sons that Sister Bednar and I have been blessed with can help you understand why we are so forthright in wanting to share this message with you. Now, our three sons are now very old, but when they were small, we lived in a home on a cul-de-sac, and we had Hot Wheels. Everybody know what Hot Wheels are? Hot Cycles, Hot Wheels. This is a tricycle that sits very low to the ground, has a very low center of gravity, and has great big fat plastic wheels on the back. The low center of gravity and the fat wheels on the back make a very cool thing possible. You ride very fast, you turn very sharp, and you can spin the back of the Hot Cycle. And our three little boys thought this was just great fun, and they were always out in the cul-de-sac riding around playing Dukes of Hazzard and Hot Cycles. One day, my wife and I are watching our sons ride their Hot Cycles, Hot Wheels. One of them goes too fast, turns too sharp, and smacks into the side of a parked car. This was not a serious accident. We could tell that he was bunged up a little bit. He had some owies on his arm and on the side of his face, but he was not in danger, so we just watched to see what his older brother would do. Now, some of you will hear the sounds in your mind as I describe what took place. They come into our home, and they go into the kitchen, and you can hear the chairs coming from the kitchen table over to the sink. The older brother turns on the water, and he then takes about one half of a bottle of Ivory dishwasher and he pours it all over his brother's arm. It's just oozing and gooing everywhere on the side of his face, and then he begins to scrub the alleys so they will be clean. What then followed can only be described as weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth by a younger brother who is just screaming because of the sting caused by the soap. Well, this proceeds for a while, and my wife and I, you probably think we're terrible parents, we were just cracking up watching this transpire. So they get all this soap scrubbed and wiped off, and then the towel. Now, then from the chair, this is just the chair at the sink, then they climb up on the counter, get into the medicine cabinet, and they get a brand new tube of Neosporin and a new box of Band-Aids. And the older brother begins to put Neosporin all over the alleys and all over his little brother's face. And then he proceeds to put Band-Aids all the way up the arm and on the side of his face. Now this is funny. There is a moral to the story. As soon as all of the Band-Aids were on Michael's arm and the side of his face, he took what was left of the tube of Neosporin and the remaining Band-Aids, and he ran outside and he started putting Neosporin and Band-Aids on his friends. Now the question is, why did he do that? He had an owie and it hurt and it could have gotten infected. And as much as he screamed when it was being cleansed, it felt better when the Neosporin was put on and then was protected by the Band-Aids. Nobody had to tell him to go out and share that with his buddies. When it made him feel better, when the pain was eased, he just instinctively and immediately wanted to go share it with his friends. Now, to those of you not of our faith, that's why we're maybe a little obnoxious in your point of view in wanting to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are real spiritual alleys, and they hurt. And you may not know where to turn for peace. And we'd like to just help you investigate, learn about, and test this message. Because we have found the balm of Gilead. We have found the solution to those spiritual alleys and the pain that they cause. And our only desire, because we love you, is to share that message with you. So to those of you not of our faith, you honor us with your presence, and we thank you for being here. And we invite you to test this message. We may not be very smooth in the way we try to introduce it to you. You may think we're too overbearing. You may think, I don't understand all this stuff about golden plates and the Book of Mormon and so on and so forth. We can help you. Our missionaries will not do anything other than help you learn about this message so you can pray and come to know for yourself if it's true. And we testify that it is. And if you will test this message and then pray with real intent and a sincere heart by the power of the Holy Ghost, you will know that these things are true. That's what happened to this good couple. Just in what, January? I don't think anybody tried to persuade them. No one certainly coerced them. They were invited to test this message, and it changes everything. And it's the most important message that you've ever heard. That's what we invite you to do. So thank you for being here today, those of you who are not of our faith. Now, to you Latter-day Saints, do you have the eyes to see and the ears to hear the miracles that have occurred here already today? I just want you to consider this young man and young woman, Wake and Rebecca. I think it's intriguing that his name is Wake. Is that right? Okay. Is that a nickname or full name? Okay. This is the reason I find that intriguing. How many young men and young women this age are even awake? On a Sunday morning. If they are awake, would they be at church? If they were awake and at church, would they have the ability to stand up in front of literally almost thousands of people without any advance notice and express the feelings of their heart and mind the way this young man and this young woman did? That's miraculous. This couple baptized in January, no advance notice, invited to the pulpit to express the feelings of their heart as if they had done it forever. All over the world, they survey people and they ask the question, what are you most afraid of? Number three, death. Number two, bugs and snakes. Number one, speaking in front of large groups of people. I understand that to mean people would rather die from a snake bite or a bug than do what these four good folks have done. Now ask this simple question, what produces people that can do that? What produces, what influences a man or a woman to change your life that dramatically, to be this age and look and behave this way? What produces that? Only a good tree can produce good fruit. Bad trees produce bad fruit. By their fruits ye shall know them. And in the lives of Latter-day Saints who are striving to follow the Master and keep His commands, you find the fruit of the restored gospel of Jesus Christ. For just a couple of minutes, I want to take you with me on some of the press interviews that I do. All over the world, everywhere we go, TV reporters, newspaper reporters want to interview us. And they don't really want to interview us, they want to make us look stupid so that they can write about the church in a negative way. But there's an interesting thing. Most of the reporters who interview us don't know very much about Christianity or about the Bible or anything else. So, I'll just be both the reporter and Elder Bednar posing and responding to questions for just a few minutes, because this is going to be your life forever. The church is not coming out of obscurity and out of darkness anymore. We are sitting in the spotlight. Because of the recent election, the press has used the term the Mormon moment. Well, it's not the Mormon moment. It's not the Mormon month. It's going to be the Mormon millennium forever. And we cannot go back to obscurity and darkness. Do you understand the consequence of that for you? If you live the gospel, you will be so weird, everyone is going to ask you, what is your deal? How come you live the way you live? How come you do what you do? You don't have to worry about baking somebody a loaf of bread. You don't have to worry about figuring out how am I going to say this. They're going to come to you and they're going to ask. Because you are different and strange from anybody in the world. And when they come and they ask, do not ever be afraid of giving a reason for the hope that is within you. That's why I want to do this question and answer just for a minute or two, so you can see how simple the answers are. If you have any apprehension about responding to any question that a person might ask you, just go to primary for 2 or 3 weeks and you'll be fine. Mr. Bednar, how did you become an apostle? Isn't that a great question? This is on a national TV program, kind of like 60 Minutes, in a country someplace in the world, live, 30 minutes, just me and the reporter. First question, Mr. Bednar, how did you become an apostle? Now, what does the reporter think? Like, how do you apply for that job? What's the career path? And how do you go about getting that kind of a job? I said, the answer is very simple. We believe that men and women are called to positions by God, by prophecy, and by the laying on of hands, by those who are in authority to preach the gospel and administer the ordinances thereof. I was called by God's prophet on the earth to be one of the 12 apostles. Can you just imagine the reaction of someone who knows nothing about the New Testament? Maybe had a few Bible stories, but all of a sudden you have introduced topics of prophets and prophecy and laying on of hands. So, Mr. Bednar, how long ago did this happen? It was approximately 9 years ago. So what do? I travel the earth bearing testimony, declaring my witness of the living reality and divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't this fun? National TV, and I'm giving missionary discussions. Mr. Bednar, there's a temple you've had a groundbreaking, or it's under construction here in our country. And we understand you do secret things in your temples. What happens in your temples? There's nothing secret in our temples, they are sacred. Mr. Reporter, what would you think of someone who had no background in journalism walking in here right now and conducting this interview with me? Mr. Bednar, you don't seem to understand. I'm asking you the questions. Now, Mr. Reporter, please, what would you think of someone who just kind of came in and assumed that position? Well, obviously they wouldn't be qualified. That's correct. The temple is where you do spiritual graduate work. And before you receive the blessings and the instruction of the temple, you need to have some basics. So there's nothing secret. It is sacred. And if you will exercise faith in Christ, repent of your sins, be baptized by immersion for the remission of sins, and demonstrate your faithfulness over a period of time, then you can come to the temple with me and I'd be glad to take you. And you can know everything that goes on there, because there's not one thing that's secret. You just have to be spiritually prepared. Isn't this fun? On national TV, in a whole country. Mr. Bednar, why are you called Mormons? We believe the Bible to be the Word of God as far as it is translated correctly. We also believe the Book of Mormon to be the Word of God. Do you find a pattern here in responding to these questions? If you know the 13 articles of faith, you can answer any question that is ever asked. What's the first article of faith? The nature of the Godhead. What's the second article of faith? The atonement of Jesus Christ and the fall of Adam. What's the third article of faith? The atonement of Jesus Christ and my individual fall. What's the fourth article of faith? The principles and authority by which the blessings of the atonement can have an effect in my life. What's the fifth article of faith? The authority necessary to preach the gospel and perform the ordinances. Brothers and sisters, all you have to do is take the 13 articles of faith, put them on a piece of paper, and to the side of the 13 articles of faith, put a one or two or three word description of each one. Godhead, atonement, fall. Godhead, atonement, fall, and me. The sequence of the 13 articles of faith is the answer to every gospel question. Now, I only did the first five, you do the rest. But if you have that sequence in your head and heart, that's what you learn in primary. And that's how you answer questions that people will pose to you about the gospel. So, Mr. Bednar, this Mormon thing, Mormon is a nickname. The proper and true name of our church is the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. It's the same church that Christ organized when he was on the earth. It's been restored in these days, the latter days, in preparation for the Savior's second coming. The Book of Mormon is a companion volume of Scripture to the New Testament. It is another testament of Jesus Christ. Mr. Reporter, here's a simple illustration of why that book is so important. If you have the Bible, and that is to help you identify truth, you can put a nail through the board of truth, if you will, the Bible, and it fixes it, but you can still turn it. You can turn it and interpret it to mean anything that you want. But if you have two nails, the New Testament of Christ, another Testament of Christ, the Book of Mormon, and you put two nails through the board of truth, you can no longer turn it to mean whatever you want. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. There are two witnesses, two companion volumes of Scripture that testify of Christ, the New Testament and the Book of Mormon. It is the Word of God. I have a copy in my briefcase, which I will be glad to leave with you, so that you can read it, study it, and examine it for yourself. And if you will pray as you read and study, then you can come to know that it's true, and that this church is what it claims to be, the restored church of Jesus Christ, and then you'll know which church you need to join. They really did kind of fluster at this point. Mr. Bednar, can you tell me about priesthood? Yes, priesthood is not men. Priesthood is the authority to act in the name of God. People want to make a big deal about men holding the priesthood. It's a very simple analogy. The priesthood provides blessings to all of God's children, regardless of color, gender, or anything else. It's kind of like an umbrella, and men have been assigned to hold it. The issue is not who holds the umbrella. The issue is, are the blessings available to all? And the answer is yes. That priesthood binds on earth and binds in heaven. Anciently, the apostles held keys. Keys are the rights and responsibilities to direct the work of the priesthood. By virtue of those keys, an ordinance performed on this earth can have efficacy and continue into eternity if it is sealed by those keys. And the apostles hold those keys. That's what priesthood is. And Mr. Reporter, that means that in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, you're not married till death do you part. There's no binding effect in civil authority that binds till death do you part. But by the power of the priesthood, in holy temples, a man and a woman can be sealed together, bound together for time and for all of eternity. Now, the ordinance alone doesn't mean that's going to happen. It means they have the opportunity, if they are true and faithful and honor that covenant, that after death, they can be together for time and all eternity. If you very simply highlight the need for additional scripture, for continuing revelation, we don't have anything that's secret. People who don't know much about our church do not know the difference between a chapel and a temple. They think temples are where we do what we're doing here today, and they think they can't come in. You have friends and neighbors who frankly would be blown away if you want to come to my church now, I can't go in there. Yeah, you can. We have chapels and we have temples. Everybody's welcome to our chapels. Everybody's welcome to our temples. You just got to do a few things before you can get there. Things that are that simple, people don't know, don't understand. You can very simply help them understand. And if you're nervous about doing that, just go to primary for 2 or 3 weeks, and everything will be fine. You'll know what to do. The 13 articles of faith and 3 weeks in primary, you can come with me to any television interview anywhere in the world, and you'll do equally as well. This gospel is simply beautiful, and it is beautifully simple. That's one of the ways you know that it's true. What's most enchanting about those interviews is that as they begin to learn, you know what happens on national TV, you can watch their hearts soften. They want to try to get you. But the gospel is so simple and so compelling. It answers the questions of the soul. Mr. Bednar, I've heard that you baptize dead people in your temples. How does that work? We do not baptize dead people. Mr. Reporter, Any Christian believes that the only name under heaven whereby a man or a woman can be saved is the name of Jesus Christ. Somewhere between 100 and 150 billion people have lived on the earth. Mr. Reporter, what do you think? How many of all those people have ever lived in a place at a time where they could even hear the name of Jesus Christ, let alone have access to a Bible? Mr. Bednar, please. I'm the reporter. I'm asking you the questions. Mr. Reporter, only a relative handful of the people who have ever lived have heard the name of Jesus Christ. How can it be that a religion that professes the only name under heaven whereby you can be saved is the name of Jesus Christ, and then the vast majority of the human population has never heard the name? Question, what happens to those people? Answer, Mr. Reporter, I mean no disrespect, but there's only one church, one Christian church, that claims to have both the authority and the doctrine that answers that question. Mr. Reporter, you are a dual being. You have a physical body made up of flesh and bones and blood. You have a spirit. That spirit resides within your physical body. It's kind of like a hand going into a glove. Your spirit was organized by your Heavenly Father. You lived with Him as His son or daughter before you were born into mortality. When you die, that's the separation of your spirit and your body. And Mr. Reporter, there will be a resurrection because of the atonement and resurrection of Jesus Christ. There is a universal resurrection. Your spirit and your body will be reunited, and your body will be restored to its perfect frame and order. And you will live eternally. Now the question is, will you have eternal life? National TV, an entire nation. It just doesn't get any better than this. In the spirit world, which is the place where your spirit goes after you die, waiting for the day of the resurrection, there are missionaries there. Those faithful souls who have had access to the gospel when they lived on the earth are engaged in teaching the people who never had the opportunity when they lived on the earth. That's where you have that opportunity. I don't know exactly why some people get the opportunity in this earth life and some people get it there, but that's how it works. Those people there have the chance to hear, to accept or reject the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Jesus wasn't kidding when he said, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. To be born of the water is to be baptized. To be born of the Spirit is to receive by the laying on of hands the gift of the Holy Ghost. You can't baptize a spirit. So we have the responsibility, as we live on the earth, to identify our own ancestors and perform those ordinances in our temples for those who never had the chance when they lived in mortality. Mr. Reporter, you can find books written by some of the most brilliant Christian theologians, and the books have titles like What Happens to Those Who Never Heard, and they don't have an answer. Only in the Church of Jesus Christ, restored to the earth in these latter days, can you find the answers to every question of the soul. Why are we here? What happens when we die? What happens to those who never heard? What happens to a family relationship at death? I've been to more than 100 nations in my 9 years of service as a member of the Quorum of the Twelve. It doesn't make any difference, the skin color, the language, the culture. Most men are pretty much the same. Most women are pretty much the same. They love their spouses and their children. They have a yearning, even a belief, that that relationship will endure beyond the grave. But you only find that doctrine in one place. You only find the authority to perform that ordinance in one place, in the restored Church of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, In the 50th section of the Doctrine and Covenants, there is a verse that I find absolutely fascinating. Verses 24 and 25 in section 50 of the Doctrine and Covenants. That which is of God is light, and he that receiveth light and continueth in God receiveth more light, and that light groweth brighter and brighter until the perfect day. Now please listen. And again, verily I say unto you, and I say it that you may know the truth, that you may chase darkness from among you. Can I read that again? And again, verily I say unto you, and I say it that you may know the truth, that you may chase darkness from among you. That's our responsibility in these latter days. The world will grow increasingly dark, and we have the responsibility to shine ever brighter as the light. We're not better, but we know different. Big difference. We don't claim to be better than other people. But where much is given, much is required. That verse is often quoted as, where much is given, much is expected. That's not right. Where much is given, much is required. We are blessed in these latter days to have the light of the gospel. And if you live it, it will be evident in your countenance. Have you received his image in your countenance? And then when it's there, people will ask you for the reason for the hope that is within you. Sister Bednar and I were in the country of Hungary, and her translator was a remarkable young woman, vivacious and engaging, physically attractive, one of the happiest young women I've ever seen in my whole life. She was a convert to the church. She had joined the church studying at a university in Budapest. I simply asked her, how did you come in contact with the church? She said, my roommate was a Latter-day Saint. What interested you about the gospel? She smiled. That was it? Yeah, she smiled. Why did it make such a big difference to you, or why were you so interested in the fact that she smiled? Because there's not much in this world to smile about. I was having troubles at home. I looked at the perplexities of all the things happening in the world, and I said to her one day, what do you smile about? There's nothing to smile about. And this good roommate simply said, I know who I am. I know God's plan. Does that sound familiar? That's called a primary hymn. Go to primary. For 3 weeks, you'll be okay. And that was the beginning of this young woman wanting to learn about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do you remember on the hot cycle, on the hot wheels, the owie, whenever you felt the relief, you just immediately and instinctively wanted to go share it with somebody else? When thou art converted, strengthen thy brother. We often think that Peter was being rebuked in that statement. That Peter, you're not measuring up. Something's wrong with you. So get converted and then you can go strengthen your brother. But consider that the strengthening and the power that enabled Peter to be an apostle and a special witness of the Lord Jesus Christ really occurred on the day of Pentecost when he received the Holy Ghost. A part of what the Savior was saying to Peter was, Peter, when you receive the Holy Ghost, then you're in a better position to go strengthen your brethren. We think somehow Peter wavered when he denied Christ 3 times. But did he ever waver after the day of Pentecost receiving the Holy Ghost? No. Brothers and sisters, baptized by immersion for the remission of sins, hands have been placed upon your head. You have access to that gift. I pray you've received it and are continuing to receive it. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. In the waters of baptism, we pledge three things. A willingness to take upon ourselves the name of Jesus Christ, that we will always remember him, and that we will keep his commandments. Those are the elements of the covenant established by God. The covenant promises that if we honor those three elements of the covenant, then we may always have his Spirit to be with us. Now, please buckle up. If you've checked out and your head is someplace else, please come back. I really need your attention for a couple of minutes to clarify a misunderstanding that is pervasive in the church. We always say agency is choosing. I can choose what I want. No, actually, you cannot. Agency is the capacity to act and not be acted upon. It's much more than choosing. And we have been blessed with moral agency through the atonement of Jesus Christ for only one reason, to choose God. It is not to choose whatever you want, whenever you will. The hymn is called Choose the Right When a Choice is Placed Before You. We have been given agency to choose the right, not choose what you want. Sometimes young people say to my parents, I don't have agency. I do what I want. No, actually you don't. You're baptized. And when you were baptized, your agency was elevated. You didn't give it up, but it was elevated. Here's how it's elevated. Prior to your baptism, it was individual agency. When you pledge your willingness to take upon yourself the name of Jesus Christ, you begin to receive his name. You don't fully, totally, and completely take upon yourself the name of Jesus Christ in the waters of baptism. We begin. The new family name is Christian. Again, I don't mean to sound light-minded, but I'm amused at people who say we're not Christians. If you understand the story of the restoration of priesthood authority, we're the only ones who in proper authority can be called Christians. In proper authority. So we begin to take upon ourselves the name of Jesus Christ. And in so doing, it becomes more important to represent him and do what he wants than what we want. Our agency is no longer individual agency, it's representative agency because we represent him. Where do we more fully and completely take upon ourselves the name of Jesus Christ? In the temple. So in the waters of baptism, in essence, we stand and accept those initial elements of the covenant and pledge, I will remember him and keep his commandments, so I will be worthy to be in the holy temple to receive those ordinances and instruction and continue and more fully and completely take upon myself the name of Jesus Christ. When we have entered into those covenants, what he wants trumps what we want. Not my will, but thy will be done. Now, can I just help you see the consequence of what I'm trying to explain? I hear members of the church all the time say, baptized, under covenant, members of the church, my agency. I have to pay my tithe. Yeah, you do. One of the elements of the covenant is keep the commandments. It doesn't say keep the commandments when it seems like what you want to do. Keep the commandments. But I have my agency. Yeah, but it's not just individual agency anymore. Now it's different. Now your agency, first and foremost, is exercised in representing him, not doing what you want. So, yeah, you can elect not to honor the elements of the covenant. Don't just call that a choice. Don't just say that's exercising individual agency. Now you are breaking the covenant to represent him. Big difference. I'm not trying to scare you, but if sometime you really don't want to go to sleep, and because you won't drink coffee, because you're obeying the word of wisdom, Go read and study in the scriptures about covenant breakers. Guarantee you, you won't sleep very well. So don't think that I have my agency and I can do what I want when I will. In successive ordinances and covenants, we yield our hearts to God. We only want to do what He wants to do. We really only want to go where He wants us to go. We only want to be what He wants us to be. And in that, we are absolutely, totally liberated. The secular world looks at that and thinks it's confinement. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That's the only way to ever be free and truly liberated. Brothers and sisters, there are some who suggest that Joseph Smith was a fraud, that he concocted all of this. How do you produce, in the short lifespan of a young man between the ages of 20 and his late 30s, the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, the Pearl of Great Price, temple ordinances, priesthood governance, how do you take something that is supposedly an American upstate New York religious philosophy, and it pervades the earth and is now established in 184 nations all over the world? How do you take someone who is a Buddhist or a Hindu or any other religious tradition, tell them the story about Joseph Smith? They read, study, and ponder the Book of Mormon. By the witness of the Holy Ghost, they come to know that it's true. How does that work all over the world in so many different places? By their fruits ye shall know them. A good tree brings forth good fruit, and a bad tree brings forth bad fruit. Brothers and sisters, we live in the greatest season in the history of the restored church. The Mormon moment, if you will, has expanded to be a marvelous flood of light. Never has the church been as well known or as well regarded. Never have we had the resources to move forward in all the earth as we do today. This is the greatest season in the history of the restored church. Do you really understand what's happening? Just in one or two specific things. We make a big deal about the youth curriculum. Okay? It goes way beyond that. With the youth curriculum, we think about Sunday school or a lot of priesthood classes, you know, women classes. But in a world where you have the overwhelming majority of the population of the earth with a cell phone in their pocket, you can go to the poorest nations on the earth, and I've been to them, and people who have nothing have a cell phone. And they have a little screen on it. And you have access to all of the learning resources the church provides. Sunday school's not in church anymore. Sunday school's on the bus. It's in your car. It's in your home. It's in your room. Technology has been revealed in these latter days so that you are not place-bound in a church building anytime, anywhere, according to your schedule and need. You have access to remarkable resources to learn the gospel. In Salt Lake City, to facilitate family history work, we have Granite Mountain Vaults. In those vaults, we have billions and billions of records about the history of humankind, identifying individuals so we can do the research and take the names to the temple to perform ordinances for the dead. You used to have to go to Salt Lake to get access to that stuff. You used to have to go to a family history center. Now, with the tree software, on the bus, in your home, anytime, anywhere. We make a big deal about the announcement of missionaries. They can now go when they're 18 or 19. Brothers and sisters, that just brings the church in North America up to speed with the rest of the church around the world. Everybody thinks that's a big new thing. We've been doing that in 45 other nations for 15 years. In South Korea, if you are a young man and you graduate from the equivalent of high school, you either go into the military, or you go into the university, or you get a job. If you go into the university, you can't leave to go on a mission. You forfeit your place forever to be in the university. So we've been doing that in places like Korea and Mexico and all over the world forever. But here at home in the United States, if a young man prepares to leave on a mission when he's 18, where's the MTC? It's in your home. It's not in Provo, it's not in Bogota, it's not in Manila. It's in your home and in the Aaronic Priesthood Quorums. Can you begin to see how the Lord is making possible all of the resources for us to fulfill our individual responsibility to learn and live the gospel? And you know what's happening as a result of that announcement about missionaries leaving at 18 and they choose to, and you're limited at 19? Since last October, 12 members of the Quorum of the 12 have assigned approximately 40 or 45,000 missionaries. We're close to 80,000 missionaries now, largest missionary force in this dispensation, and it's just going to keep getting bigger. Do you understand what that means? They're coming here. They're already here. In this mission, they had a complement of 140 missionaries. Now they have 250. Everywhere in the world. On the 1st of July, we open up 58 missions. We'll have 405 missions all over the earth. Now, could I just say something as directly as you're ever going to hear it? Stop praying for the missionaries to find people to teach. That's your job. The days of praying, oh, please help the missionaries find somebody. No, you find them. You pray for the faith. You pray for the strength. Rise up. The days of praying that those who are not here this week, please bless them that they'll be here next week. Could I go back to Salt Lake and say, in Scranton, I obtained a commitment from the faithful saints that they're not going to do that anymore. They're not just going to pray that somehow magically people who aren't here are going to show up next week. Here's the prayer I wish, I pray, somebody, sometime would pray and do it with real faith. Let's assume we're in a sacrament meeting. Heavenly Father, we're now concluding sacrament meeting. We have felt thy spirit, we love thee, we thank thee for the blessings of this day. Heavenly Father, we will not in this prayer pray for those who are not here today to be here next week. We're going to go get them right now. On our way home, we're going to stop at the home of someone that we know. And we'll ask them, is there something I can do to be of assistance? I'll look and I'll see what I can do to be of assistance. If they're sick, I'll minister to them. If they are offended, I'll try to help heal them. And we're going to go right now. Because everybody in this congregation knows somebody who's not here who ought to be. Could be. Should be. Heavenly Father, we're not going to have a meeting to plan it and talk about it. Because we do that all the time, then we never do anything. We're not going to create some new chart to gather statistics about how many go and calculate a percentage of how many went. Now, Heavenly Father, I suspect the bishop is getting real nervous listening to me pray right now. And if he doesn't like what I'm praying, he can invite me to sit down. And if he doesn't, I'm going to keep going. We're going now, and we're going to get them. Now, Heavenly Father, we need thy help with only one thing, because we know how to go do this. We will be thy hands. We will be thy voice. Please inspire us so we don't all go to the same house. Amen? Let's go. If I had the wish of my heart, I would speak with the voice of thunder, but I can't. Rise up. And the time is now. I'm not rebuking you. I'm trying to encourage you and admonish you. It's not enough to go through the motions, show up on Sunday. As disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, this is all day, every day, everywhere, all the time, no exceptions. We are his representatives. So you and I can chase the darkness from among us. As we honor covenants and keep the commandments, the light will shine. People will ask. Go to primary. Remember the articles of faith. And don't ever be afraid to give a reason for the hope that is within you. My beloved brothers and sisters, I love you. This is my kind of stake. As an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, I declare my witness. I don't just know, nor do I simply testify. I witness that God, the eternal Father, is our Father and that He lives. That Jesus the Christ is His only begotten Son. He is our Savior and our Redeemer. And I witness that the tomb is empty, that He is resurrected, that He lives. He stands at the head of His church and directs its affairs. I know that He speaks. I witness that He lives. I witness that the Father and the Son appeared to Joseph, and that through Joseph Smith, the fullness of the gospel has been restored to the earth in these latter days. I can't express, and for reasons I will never comprehend, having been called to this office, I, by ordination and the laying on of hands, have received all of the keys restored to the earth in these latter days. Those keys are held in totality by each individual member of the First Presidency in the Quorum of the Twelve. And I witness that those keys are real. They bind on earth and they bind in heaven. They loose on earth and they loose in heaven. All of these things, brothers and sisters, are true, and we live in the most magnificent season in the history of the restored church. As we now conclude this time together, I invoke upon you a blessing. Even the blessing that you may more fully see and understand the blessings that you have received. The blessing that your desire for righteousness will increase. That the desire will fuel your faith, which is a principle of action. That you will align your life more completely with the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. As you do so, I promise, the light will burn ever brighter in your countenance, and you will have the capacity to chase the darkness from among you, in your individual life, in your family, in your branches and wards, and in this state of Zion, that it may be a standard unto the nations. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Amen.